very seductive, and people wanted to touch Ziggy. David had been experimenting with a lot of looks, a lot of sounds, a lot of styles. None of them had quite clicked until Ziggy. And I think it was really once he got that haircut, he couldn't go wrong.
Now Ziggy played guitar.
He was coming around the back. I've been waiting for ages to see him.
Why are you so upset?
He's smashing.
You're David Bowie's wife, right?
Yes, I am.
What's it like with all these girls loving your husband so much?
Absolutely fabulous. Wouldn't you love to be loved by so many?
Bowie's success was due in part to the hard, muscular sound of his guitar player, Mick Ronson, a sound that would help push Bowie to the top of the British charts. But Ronson could also play in a reflective style that gave the Ziggy character a real depth and range.
When I first heard him play, I thought, oh, that's my Jeff Beck. He is fantastic. This kid is great. And so I sort of hoodwinked him into working with me. I didn't quite actually have to tell him in the beginning that we'd have to wear makeup and all that. Because Mick came from Hull, you know, and was very down to earth, as was the rest of the spider. You know, what do you mean, makeup? I said, well, it might sort of. And so I reverted to things like, you looked very green tonight on stage. If you wore makeup, you'd probably look a little more natural looking. And sort of lies like this, and gradually got them into sort of, you know, areas of costume and theatre. And actually, when they realised how many girls they could pull when they looked so sort of otherworldly, they took to it like a fish to water.
For me, when I was on stage, I was kind of doing what I had to do, you know. I mean, just as a, I guess what I felt I had to do, I felt like the way I played, you know. I think a lot of people saw it as a very good sort of counterfoil between me and David, because David would be more delicate and a little more woman-like. And I was kind of like stomping along on the side there, a bit more like a, I can't really say bricklayer, but that's kind of what I mean, you know.
I'm very much a character when I go on stage, I feel. I mean, I...
Like an actor?
Yeah, I believe in my part all the way down the line, right the way down. But I do play it for all it's worth, because that's the way I do my stage thing. That's part of what Bowie's supposedly all about. I'm an actor. I'm a spacious man. I'll
be around the world facing you. The chief ingredients were to de-violence the look of Clockwork Orange. Evoke the mystery of Kabuki and No Theatre. But if you'd asked me at the time what it was I was trying to do, I had simply no idea. All I knew it was, and I sound like a parrot saying this, but it's true. And this otherness, this other world, an alternative reality, one that I really wanted to embrace. I wanted anything but the place that I came from.
Bowie started to rely heavily on his manager, Tony DeFries, who surrounded him with all the extravagances of a major star, despite the fact that there was not always the money to pay for it.
Tony DeFries had this idea that if we just told the world that I was super huge and then treated me as though I were, then something might happen.
In Britain, the strategy worked perfectly. Bowie's albums sold extremely well. But in America, the real prize market, It was a different story. RCA Records was looking for someone to beef up their roster, which for years had relied heavily on Elvis. DeFries sold Bowie to them, saying that Bowie would be a new queen of rock and roll to replace the king. But it soon became clear that a mainstream American audience was not yet ready for a rock star from outer space with a penchant for cross-dressing. And Ziggy made no impact on the U.S. charts at all.
The whole glam thing, like, was kind of great for me when I met Bowie and he was into that, and so I got into that. It was something I had already seen with Warhol, but I hadn't done that then. So the 70s was like a chance for me to get in on it. I mean, that was one of the great things. You could, and I learned that from Andy. You could be anything.
When Bowie met Lou Reed again in New York, Reed was at a low point in his solo career after leaving the Velvet Underground.
David Bowie is produced your last two albums, is that right?
Oh, no. Yeah.
Just one album?
One.
What was it like working with him?
Oh, it was a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun. But when he gets drunk, he thinks he's Ziggy.
Working with Bowie, Reed drew on the people who had inspired him in the first place, the hookers, the junkies, and cross-dressers of New York street life.
Holly came from Miami, FLA, hitchhiked away across USA, plucked her eyebrows on the way, shaved her legs, and then he was a she. She says, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey, honey, take a walk on the wild side.
Walk on the Wild Side had been banned from the BBC, as it was banned in the United States. What kind of repressive culture would ban a song?
Candy came from out on the island. In the back room, she was everybody's darling.
They were versions in the United States that were only 14 seconds long. Just go bleep, 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 do, 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 bleep, bleep, bleep.
Said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. And the colored girls go do, 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 do.
Again, that desire to stir things up and move them a bit was there.
Ladies and gentlemen, straight from this fantastically successful world tour.
Back in Britain, Bowie's fame continued to grow, but a sellout tour of the country ended unexpectedly when he gave a final concert at the Hammersmith Odeon.
Not only is it the last show of the tour, but it's the last show that we'll ever do. Thank you.
Bye-bye, we love you.
Bowie retired Ziggy Stardust, but his meteoric success had spawned a whole new movement in Britain, known as glam rock. Not since the days of Little Richard had the charts seen so much flamboyant showbiz glitter. Even hardened old veterans like the Rolling Stones jumped on the bandwagon. By June 1974, Bowie was ready for something new. Another assault on America.
I'm an alligator. Oh, I'm a mama, papa, calling for you. How was the space invader? I'll be a rock and roll bitch for you. Keep your mind shut.
For his Diamond Dogs tour across the United States, out went the makeup and stockings, and in came nicely cut soul boy suits.
I started writing songs city by city. The one that I immediately remember, of course, is Gene Genie was definitely out of Detroit and focused around Iggy. An Iggy-type character, to be fully fair. It wasn't actually Iggy. But I wanted a new music, some more musical texture to go into it. And again, jazz was kind of rearing its head. And a juxtaposition of somebody who was right out of left-field jazz working with what we were doing, which was fairly conventional rock and roll, was really kind of interesting.